Welcome to the Civil War, a Study Guide. This episode will discuss the advantages and disadvantages that the North and the South had at the beginning of the Civil War, and the battle strategies of the North and the South, as well as some of the important leaders on both sides of the war. The Northern position about the Civil War was the secession win against the Constitution. Their purpose for fighting was to preserve the Union and keep the country together. The Southern position about the war was the states had the right to secede. They've used the Declaration of Independence to justify that decision. They fought to maintain their states' rights. Originally, South Carolina, Georgia, Florida, Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana, and Texas seceded from the United States. They were joined by North Carolina, Tennessee, Arkansas, and Virginia, making a total of 11 states that seceded or left the United States to make their own country. The western part of Virginia favored staying with the Union, so rather than trying to force them to secede, they chose to split the state in half and make two states, Virginia that seceded and West Virginia that remained a part of the Union. Now, there were some states that were right along the edge of the North and the South that are called border states. They had slaves, but they chose not to secede. Those states were Delaware, Kentucky, Missouri, and Maryland. It's kind of interesting to know that the South was so certain the Missouri and Kentucky were going to secede that when they created their first flag, they actually put in 13 stars. And even though Missouri and Kentucky never were successful at getting a vote to secede, the South still kept their stars on the Confederate flag. Some of the important leaders of the Civil War was obviously Abraham Lincoln, who was elected the President of the Union. His election in 1860 is actually what sparked the decision to secede from the Union. The South knew that he had run on an abolitionist platform, and they were afraid of what he would do about slavery once he became president. Ulysses S. Grant was one of the primary generals in the Civil War. There were many, many other generals, and this is just a few of them. George B. McClellan, Winfield Scott, Irvin McDowell, Joseph Hooker, William Tecumseh Sherman, Andrew Foote, John Pope, Ambrose Burnside, George Meade, and General George Armstrong Custer. This is just a very small portion of the generals that were on the Union side. The North actually changed their commanding general about four times throughout the war because Lincoln was unhappy with their performance. Jefferson Davis was elected the president of the Confederacy, the South, or the Confederate States of America, and the primary general for the South was Robert E. Lee. Now, Robert E. Lee was a West Point instructor. He actually taught battle strategy. He therefore had a distinct advantage in the war because not only could he predict what the opposing generals would do, he's the one that taught them to do it. So he actually understood their thinking as well. He was such a good military strategist that Abraham Lincoln actually asked him to lead the United States Army. But he was from Virginia, and he decided he had to stay loyal to his state. He was a slave owner, and so therefore he chose to fight for the South. Some of the other Confederate generals were P.G.T. Beauregard, Thomas J. Stonewall Jackson, Joseph Johnston, George Pickett, Albert Sidney Johnston, John Bell Hood, Jeb Stuart, and James Longstreet. And again, these are just a few of the generals and leaders that were on both sides of the Civil War. President Lincoln argued that preserving the Union was the primary reason to fight. He's recorded as saying, "If I could save the Union without freeing any slaves, I would do it. And if I could save it by freeing all of the slaves, I would do it. And if I could save it by freeing some and leaving others alone, I would also do that." His main purpose in going to war was to preserve the Union. Now, the South had advantages and disadvantages at the beginning of the Civil War. Some of the advantages that the South had were the 11 states in the Confederacy. They had the excellent military leadership of Robert E. Lee. They were fighting in their own land, so they knew the territory, and he could fight a defensive war. That meant they could wait until the North came down and attacked them. Some of the disadvantages that the South had at the beginning of the war: they had 9 million citizens, but 3.5 million of them were slaves, and they were not allowed to fight. That effectively lowered the population of the South to 4.5 million. They had to form a government and direct a war at the same time. Each state wanted to keep its own rights and privileges. Each state also sent supplies to their own troops only. The South had to worry about slave revolts and the border states. The South also had very poor transportation, minimal railroads, and they had a distinct lack of industry. They did not have the manufacturing capability in the factories to make more weapons, ammunition, clothing, all the things that they would need. The North had advantages and disadvantages at the start of the Civil War also. Some of their advantages were the 22 million citizens. That was 4 times the non-slave population of the South. They had a strong industrial and agricultural strength. They had the industry to make the weapons and the ammunition and the clothing and keep people fed. They, of course, had Abraham Lincoln's leadership. There was a very strong transportation system, including a very complex railroad system, that allowed for easy transportation of men, goods, and supplies, as well as weapons and cannons throughout the North. They also had a very strong navy, something that the South did not have. Disadvantages for the North were that they had people in the North who were called Copperheads that were fighting against the war. They called themselves Northerners for Peace, but what they actually were Southern sympathizers who were not anxious to get rid of slavery because they were making a profit from it. Another disadvantage for the North was the belief that the war would only last for 90 days. Later on in the war, by 1863, the North was having difficulty getting men to sign up and had to institute a draft being where you are required to fight in the military whether you want to or not. Their fighting was going to be in unfamiliar land. They were going to have to go into the South in order to fight, and most of them were not familiar with the territory. The North was extremely overconfident. The Northern Army was very large, but it was also very poorly trained. Now, the battle strategies were set at the beginning of the war for both sides. The Union had the strategy called the Anaconda Plan. It's called Scott's Great Snake because it was the idea of General Winfield Scott. He suggested to Lincoln that the only way to win this war was to surround the South and squeeze them off. Lincoln knew if he followed this plan, it meant that the war was going to last for a long time, because this is not something that was going to happen quickly. The Anaconda Plan consisted of 3 main parts. 1, blockade all the southern ports. That way it would block all their trade with Europe. They were not going to be able to get any goods in or out. Seize control of the Mississippi River, which would prevent the South from using it to move troops and to resupply their troops. And capture Richmond, Virginia. For the Confederacy, their battle strategy was very simple. They were simply going to fight a defensive war. They were going to stay at home, let the North come to them and attack them, and hope that they got tired of war and eventually just gave up. They were also going to rely on European nations to provide them with money and supplies in exchange for their cotton and goods that they would send out. The Civil War was fought in 3 main areas, the East, the West, and the Trans-Mississippi. At the beginning of the war, the Confederates were required to choose a new flag. They couldn't keep flying the American flag. Surprisingly, the Confederate flag that we all think of is actually the battle flag that was carried throughout the war. It wasn't the official flag of the Confederate States of America. Both sides also had to choose distinctive uniforms. I mean, we had been the same army, so everyone had the same uniforms. Official uniform for the Union was blue, and the official uniform for the South was a gray jacket with a bluish-gray pant. And that gives you the basic information you need on the advantages and disadvantages and the battle strategies of the North and the South at the beginning of the Civil War.